But to just refresh your memory, Mr. Rod-Larsen is the president of the International Peace Institute and the special envoy of the United Nations Secretary General and senior advisor on the Middle East. He began his career as an academic, studying history, philosophy, public administration, and sociology at the University of Bergen and Oslo. And of course, Bergen is a beautiful place. I visited a couple of times for conferences. And it's a great place to go for hikes. I wasn't fit enough, but great place. And this was before he established FIFO, Institute for Applied Sciences in Oslo in 1981. He served as the first director of FIFO from 1982 to 1983. Under his leadership, FIFO became increasingly involved in international peace research and politics, especially in the Middle East from the late 1980s. He and his institute played a central role in bringing about the Oslo Accords, which were signed by the Israeli and Palestinian leaderships on the front lawn of the White House in 1993, and of course generated a lot of optimism about the resolution of the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. Of course, it was those accords that also inaugurated the Oslo peace process. And Mr. Rod-Larsen became a UN Under-Secretary General responsible for coordinating the Middle East peace process. Of course, that process has somewhat unraveled, but we hope very much that it will pick up, and there's much of effort still required on your part. He was appointed as president of the International Peace Institute in 2005. The institute is based in New York, just across from the United Nations headquarters, and it's dedicated to promoting the prevention and settlement of conflicts between and within states. I'm absolutely delighted that Mr. Roed-Larsen has been able to take time off from a very busy schedule, and I think he's had a very full day. And sir, you certainly deserve to relax after this lecture, and I hope you will be able to provide that, to take time off and come and address us tonight on the topic of the Middle East and turmoil, challenges and opportunities. Mr. Rod-Larsen will talk about half an hour, and then we will open the floor for questions and answer. Would you please join me in welcoming Mr. Rod-Larsen?
Thank you very much for those kind words. I'm afraid, listening to that long list of what I've been doing, you make me feel very, very old. Anyhow, it's a great pleasure to be here. It's my first time in Canberra, and actually my first time in Australia. And I've had a fantastic day here and also in Brisbane over the weekend. I learned to know a lot about your country and also actually a lot about the politics here. I understand I came in the middle of a very big Shakespearean drama, and I've been following it very carefully. It's also a great pleasure for me to see some old colleagues here, former ambassador to Israel, former ambassador to New York, who I've been working very closely with on many, many difficult issues, and also the Norwegian ambassador, my home country, and other friends I can see here in the audience. I'm going to speak about a very complex and a very difficult issue, so I have to speak in a nutshell to describe the situation in the Middle East, to create a little bit of a map for it, is an incredibly difficult task. But let me start with saying that the political landscape of the Middle East these days are going through tectonic shifts. Sadly, the Arab-Israeli conflict is being moved a little bit to the margins of where the center of gravity in the Middle East is now. The Arab-Israeli conflict has been the political center of gravity for decades, but today Syria is the center of what is driving issues in the Middle East. So I will start with saying a few words about how I see the crisis in Syria. The Syrian situation is a devastating humanitarian crisis. It is a brutal civil war. It is a clandestine, by and large, regional war, and it has global connections. the humanitarian crisis. We now have above 1 million refugees from Syria. We have 2.5 million displaced people. Just over the last few weeks, the number of refugees grew from 700,000 to 1 million, and the displaced from 2 million to 2.5 million. It is reasonable to expect that these numbers might double or triple within the next few months. And what complicates the situation is that it will be very difficult for these refugees to return in the foreseeable future, because the devastation of the Syrian cities is of such a nature that the recovery process, when the civil war is over, might take years, which means that we will have a continued refugee crisis in all the neighboring countries. In Jordan, in Lebanon, in Turkey, but also in Iraq. In the civil war, 70,000 people, and probably more, have been killed. Tens of thousands are injured, tens of thousands are maimed. The monstrosity of what is going on is sadly and starkly illustrated that it's about 50,000 combatants from the regime which are being killed and about 10,000 from the rebel forces, which adds up to 2/3 of those are killed are children, women and men, civilians. Regional war. Syria is a country of civil war, but it's more. It is also a regional war being fought on Syrian territory. On the one side, there is an axis which runs from Tehran to Baghdad, to Damascus, to Hezbollah. On the other hand, you have a block of countries, Turkey, Jordan, some of the key Gulf countries, France, UK, and the US, who are supporting the rebels. With money, some of them with hardware. And there are also foreign fighters on the ground in Syria. So it's not only a civil war, it's a regional war. And it also, with the international connections with Russia and China voting in the Security Council, blocking international intervention, and the US and France and UK moving in the opposite direction, there are also seeds of a new Cold War. So this makes Syria very different from the other crises we have in the Middle East, because it's not only local, it's regional, and it's in many ways global. It's a new grand game in the Middle East, which springs out of the Syrian debacle, of the Syrian imbroglio. It's a new grand chess game. And there are two different chess games going on. There is one chess game on the table, which is played by diplomats at the UN and elsewhere. But there is also another chess game going on under the table, which is predominantly played by intelligence services. And in many ways, is this move from the diplomatic arena to the from the overt diplomatic arena to the covert intelligence arena is driven by the stalemate in the Security Council. Because in the chess game on the table, everybody's calling for demilitarizing the conflict and a diplomatic, non-military solution to it. But all the key players know that as the crisis is standing today, a diplomatic solution is either extremely difficult or impossible. Even more, many do not want a diplomatic solution. They want a military solution. So the real game is the chess game under the table. And in many ways, the diplomatic game is window dressing. I do personally believe that it's a question of time before the regime in Damascus falls, but it might take a very long time, which means that we will have more dead, we will have more wounded, we will have more maimed, we will have more refugees. And I do also, unfortunately, believe that after the fall of the regime, there's a high likelihood of a second civil war, because the opposition is so split between so many factions. You have secular liberal groups, you have a variety of either of moderate groups related to Islam, but you have also a large number of radical Islam jihadist groups in the country. In Syria, there was a phrase which was used for many, many years, namely Greater Syria. And Greater Syria was code for understanding Lebanon as a part of Syria. Today, we have the opposite. We have Greater Lebanon, because Lebanon now, in many ways, encompasses Syria, in the sense that we are moving full speed towards a similar situation in Syria as we've had in Lebanon for many years, and to the gruesome civil war which haunted that country for so many years. So unfortunately, what I foresee in Syria is many, many years, maybe decades, of chaos, warlordism, gangland, before we see where the country might move after that chaos. And in addition, there are significant chances of spillover. There's been cross-border fire into all the neighboring countries. Actually, just before I came here, I received news that Syrian rebels today killed 48 Syrian soldiers on Iraqi territory. And this is now increasing every day, endangering the stability of Lebanon, endangering the stability of Jordan, endangering the stability of Turkey. I'll give you one example. In an area in Syria, which is mountainous and where there in the winter can be over 2 meters of snow, there lives about 12 million people. That area is served only by one electricity grid. If that electricity grid goes down during the fighting, you will have 12 million people who will be on the run. And the only way they can go is to the neighboring countries. And a small country like Jordan, if there comes 1 million or 2 million refugees over the border, they cannot sustain it. It will threaten the political stability of the country and threaten the very possibility of governance in that country. It is impossible for a country like Jordan to sustain it. Lebanon, the same. And one has to be aware that the political context in these different countries are also very different. In Lebanon, it is very difficult to even imagine that new camps of refugees should be established. There are camps and communities of Palestinians in Lebanon, which has been very difficult to handle, which has been very generously handled by the Lebanese government, but to now have a new system of camps, maybe with a significant higher number of Syrian refugees than Palestinian refugees, is a nightmare for the country, and again, can threaten the stability of the country. For Turkey, it's also very difficult, because it's most Sunni refugees who are on the Turkish side. But in the area where they are is alawi. There's a high number of Turkish alawis, which means that there's a potential for new conflicts in those areas of Turkey. So I'm just saying this to illustrate that it's also an enormous fear for the spillover. This can spread to all these countries, and it can spread further. It can easily spread like wildfire with rivers of blood. IPI, the International Peace Institute, 2 weeks ago organized a retreat for all the neighboring countries and other key players in the region and key international players. Australia was also represented there. And also with the key agencies who are working on the humanitarian issues. This was a retreat to try to analyze what are the requirements for the international community related to the humanitarian situation. We also had ICRC there, UNHCR, UNDP, etc. And it was very sad to see at the end of the retreat that everybody agreed that the humanitarian international effort is not coping with the situation as it is, and that it will not be capable of handling the situation if it moves in the direction I just indicated. And all the key players who've been on the ground there were of the opinion that within the next few months we will have the kind of worst case scenario I described. The conclusion, as one of the humanitarian organizations formulated it, the international community's effort is dysfunctional and will be increasing dysfunctional unless something radical is done with it. Let me step a little bit back and compare the situation in the Middle East now with the revolutions there in several countries, Egypt, Tunisia, Yemen, Syria, Libya, etc. And compare it with two revolutions in fairly recent history. And fairly recent is 1848, and even more recent is 1989 in Eastern Europe. In 1848, you had slogans across Europe, which were actually very similar to the slogans in 1989 and very similar to the slogans which carried or initiated the various revolutions we witnessed over the last 2 years in the Middle East. In 1848, it was called liberalism. That was a call for freedom of speech, freedom of assembly, elected parliaments, etc. And it was the second slogan was a slogan of constitutional monarchies. In 1989, it was very similar demands, and in many ways, 1848 was fulfilled in 1989. But there are two enormous differences between these revolutions. In 1848, nearly everything went wrong. After a while, the people turned against the revolutionaries, and the old autocratic regimes came back, and some new autocratic regimes, which were worse than the previous regimes, also came back. So it was revolutions which failed. In 1989, in a way, the opposite happened. By and large, it went well. So the question is, why did it go bad in 1848, and why did it go comparatively well in 1989? The answer is that, to me, the answer is that in 1848 there were no regional institutional arrangements which could support the democratic movements, who could provide incentives to move them in the right direction. In 1989, these institutional arrangements were there, predominantly the European Union. Because in order to overcome the economic and socioeconomic miseries in these countries, you had to get money from the European Union, but in order to do that, you had to qualify. You had to prove that you have a good human rights record and institutions who could take care of human rights. You had to prove that you had free and fair elections, etc., etc. In the Middle East today, I think we have a situation which is more similar to 1848 and 1989. Because there are no satisfactory institutional mechanisms which can move this in the right direction. And we need them to make the humanitarian effort not only in Syria but also elsewhere, not dysfunctional but functional. We need them for security stability. We need them for economic recovery. We need them for socioeconomic improvements. Looking at, again, to 48 and 89, there are sad developments in these countries, in most of these countries in the Middle East. Those who initiated and led the revolutions, the young people under 25 years of age, who were who had aspirations of creating societies of a with good governance and with democratic institutions, they are all completely sidelined. And instead, you have political parties. It's too early to judge, the jury is still out, but some of the signs are bad. The worst fear is, of course, that there will be now, instead of the classic dictatorships in the region over the last 20, 30 years, that you will have new theocratic regimes but are also of an autocratic nature. I saw a study recently that the new regime in Egypt has arrested more journalists than President Mubarak did over the last 30 years, just to exemplify. I'm not saying that the developments there are is moving only in one direction. There are ambiguities. But there are phenomena in several of the countries here, in Tunisia, in Egypt, also in Yemen, which gives reason for worries where this is heading. So the crisis is deep. And today's struggle is a struggle between competing ideologies, between Shias and Sunnis, between moderate versions of Islam and radical versions of Islam, between dreams of theocratic, of establishing new theocratic states, and visions of secular states. So I'm giving you a map of this political landscape in the Middle East, which provides feelings, I'm sure you feel it, of doom and gloom. And I hope I've not given you a sleepless night tonight. However, the deeper a crisis is, the better the opportunities are for making radical changes. And what we have to look at is these opportunities. And I believe that the international community, the key players in the region, have to work together and international organizations to provide a framework for the region which can give incentives to move it forward, to move the different countries forward in the right direction. This was the reason why the Council of Europe was created in Europe. This was the reason why OSCE was created. This is the reason, or this was the vision of those who produced the ideas of a European Union. It has to be built step by step, but we have to start somewhere. When we had this meeting 2 weeks ago on Syria and the humanitarian issues, this is precisely the thought. You have to bring all the actors together to get a common map of the terrain, to have a cooperation about how you set priorities and how you implement those priorities. And what we saw in that meeting is that what is the greatest hindrance for this is jealousies, turf wars, and intrigues between different international organizations. And in a way, the whole setup for humanitarian assistance was created for totally different situations. And we have now to address these issues. And this is an opportunity to do it, because if we don't do it, more people will die, more people will suffer. So we are in the middle of maybe the deepest crisis in the Middle East since the second, or we are at the beginning of the most difficult crisis probably in the Middle East since the Second World War. But this is also an opportunity to have a hard look at the issues and how we in the international community operate in order to handle such a crisis. So with these words, thank you for your kind attention, and I will take questions. I was asked if I would take a few questions, but I'd actually like to have many questions. Thank you so far.
Well, thank you very much for explaining the complexity of the Middle East so lucidly and insightfully. And of course, also, the prospects don't look all that bright. But let me kick off the discussion, if I could use my prerogative as the moderator, by asking you, I mean, you said that there's a grand game is being played out in Syria and over Syria. Do you see the possibility of a grand bargain to bring about peace to Syria? Perhaps a grand bargain between China, the Soviet, Russia, and the United States. There has to be trade-offs in order to reach some sort of a understanding over Syria. And the second question that I want to ask you is that you talked about regional institutions to bring about peace. And 48, I mean, the current situation in the Middle East is very similar to the 48 situation in Europe. But you do have the Arab League and the Gulf Cooperation Council. Mm-hmm. Do you think they have the potential for becoming such institutions?
This was many questions in one. Let me first take the possibilities of a grand bargain. I must say that given the institutional setup which we have now, I'm deeply pessimistic about it. The reason is that for many of the countries which belongs to what I call the bloc, the overriding issue is not Syria, the overriding issue is Iran. And it's not the nuclear issues which is at the core of it. For these countries, the overriding issue on Iran is a perception that Iran has ambitions, has imperial ambitions in the region, ambitions of hegemony and dominance in the region. And they see Syria as a major tool for moving forward that ambition. And also proxies like Hezbollah, etc., in their eyes. So the battle of Syria for them is actually a battle about Iran's influence. And this is why you have to see these regional components and the nuclear issue. I don't think anybody thinks that Iran, if they get a nuclear capacity, will drop a bomb over the Gulf states or over Israel. But they see it as a very dangerous diplomatic tool. And they don't want them to have it. And this is related to the perception of what the ambition is. It's very interesting, when I travel the region, everybody in the Arab world talks about the possibilities of a nuclear capability for Iran. But I never hear them talking about Israel, who actually have a nuclear capability. And the perception is that Israel's capabilities have defensive purposes and not offensive purposes. But they perceive that a nuclear capacity for Iran has offensive intentions. And this is why this is at the top of it. So so Syria is seen as a tool, Hezbollah is seen as a tool, the nuclear bomb is seen as a tool. And this is why, unless you address this core issue, you cannot have a grand bargain. And I do believe that the scope of the 5+1 setup negotiating with Iran on the nuclear is too narrow. And I believe that only a regional structure for security cooperation, like OSCE for instance, would be capable of making some kind of negotiated solution to it. But such an organization has to encompass Iran and also Israel. And that's a very bitter pill to swallow for many of the countries in the region. But what I'm saying is that if there is a time in modern history where this might be possible, it's now. And actually there are two organizations which have Israel and Iran as members, where actually the heads of states sit in the same hall, and that is first the UN, where the heads of states and prime ministers come every year to the UN General Assembly in September. We're sitting in the same hall, in the same building. And also there is a regional organization for security cooperation in Central Asia called SICA. It's the same. Both Iran and Israel are there. I was at their last ministerial meeting, and there were representatives both from Iran and from Israel. So I mean, it is possible. And as I said, there is a huge opportunity for doing doing this now. And I think there is a lack of leadership here. And it, the second part of your question, what was that?
Whether the Arab League and
the role in? I think both the Arab League and the GCC has done a very good job related to the upheavals there. And the GCC has added a new dimension to its activities, particularly concerning what they've done in mediation and diplomacy in Yemen. But the Arab League is the Arab League. It doesn't encompass Israel and it doesn't encompass Iran. The GCC is an organization for the Gulf countries. It doesn't encompass Iran and Israel. So what my point is that if we are to establish a security framework in that region, the protagonists have to be in the same organization.
Thank you very much. I'd like to open the floor.
Okay, we'll go first there.
Could you just hold on to the mic?
Could you please introduce yourself? My name is Donald Nordblum, just an undergraduate student here. It's quite loud. So you've said that at this stage, international involvement is necessary and an internal solution isn't really viable. I'm just wondering, what do you think the likelihood of a solution which doesn't involve any military sort of activity, what do you think the likelihood of that kind of solution is?
As I alluded to, or maybe more, is that most of the key players now do not believe that there is a diplomatic solution. And I, for my part, do not believe that there is a diplomatic solution. Maybe half a year ago it was possible. And this is of several reasons. One is that I believe that the Syrian regime and its president, because of dignity issues, it will fight to the last bullet and the last drop of blood. I don't think there is a diplomatic solution, because the demand from the regime is that, yes, they will accept a new constitution, which is democratic, put it to a referendum, it will get a majority, and then there has to be free and fair elections for a president, maybe with international observers, but the basic premise is that Bashar al-Assad should be allowed to run. And there is no way that the opposition and the key countries who are against him in the region will accept at this stage such a requirement. This is why, in my opinion, there is no room for a diplomatic solution. But it's even worse, because it's not only so that some are saying it's inevitable, there are many who do not wish a diplomatic solution there, because it has become so personal between the head of state of Syria and some of the heads of states in his neighborhood that they don't want him there. And I would say it even harsher, they don't want him alive. So this is why maybe half a year ago, maybe a year ago, it would have been possible, but not now. We are beyond that.
Good evening, Jessica Swan from a postgraduate student at the College of Arab and Islamic Studies and also ABC. Just in light of the figures that you've given in terms of refugee movements and in consideration of the potential for months to come, how would you recommend Australia perceive their responsibilities in terms of these refugee movements?
I think the most important thing for all countries who wish to assist on the humanitarian situation is now to participate in the efforts we have initiated in order to find better coordination, to set priorities, how to work on the ground, and then to, on that basis, to provide resources which is agreed upon, whether it's in kind or it's in financial terms. So the most important thing is that Australia comes into this collective effort. And I'm saying the same message to everybody.
Hi, Gemma Huggins from the Department of Prime Minister and Cabinet. Do you think that this crisis somehow exposes a weakness of the UN? And if so, to react or to address the crisis? And if so, what measures do you think, or what changes could be put in place in the UN to address the crisis? For example, is there room for a military wing or something to put in place to address these crises in the future?
I mean, UN action, on the humanitarian side, the UN is doing whatever it can through OCHA, its coordination unit for humanitarian affairs, through UNDP, through UNHCR, the refugee agency. It is the issues in the Security Council which is at the core here. And here, I think the stalemate in the Council, which doesn't make the UN look particularly good, is driven from two fundamentally different conceptions of what sovereignty for a country means, where those who are blocking an international intervention believe that it's illegitimate of the UN to move into such a conflict, where there is another definition of sovereignty, which basically says that it's not only the UN's right, but it's the UN's duty to override traditional concepts of sovereignty for a humanitarian intervention or an intervention based on principles of responsibility to protect. So this is the conceptual and philosophical and political collision which we see in the Council, and it reveals that you have deeply different perceptions of what the UN is all about.
You have a very satisfied audience there, okay. That's a stop.
I was wondering if you could give us a sense of the opposition in Syria, kind of the rebel movement, and how divided or not it is, and also what we can expect to see if Assad is ousted, what kind of leadership will be and what kind of system they will enforce or try to enforce.
I'm afraid that my answer to that question will add to the doom and gloom, because the opposition is very split along many lines. You have on the ground in Syria, you have myriads of groups, from Al-Qaeda to moderate Islamists to Muslim Brotherhood. You have secular groups, you have liberal secular groups. And there are also a disconnect of some degrees between the rebels and the opposition in Syria and those who are outside Syria. So that's also a pretty bleak picture. Key actors in the region and internationally, there is now efforts by Qatar to bring the different factions together in order to unify them. And there's been an effort to do this over the last 2 years, but so far it's not been very successful, though there's been made some progress. And this is one of the reasons why the Lebanization of Syria, if I may use that phrase, where the country is split in many, many factions, and where you have warlords and militias, etc., is, as the situation is now, the most likely. And this might lead to, as I said, a second civil war after the fall of the Assad regime.
Hey. Helen Freeman, and I'd like to ask a question about the contributions made to humanitarian assistance by the wealthy Arab countries.
And I cannot give a precise answer to that, but I know that the key Gulf countries like Saudi Arabia, Qatar, and UAE and others are giving significant amounts of money to the humanitarian assistance, but I don't know the figures, because most of this assistance is done directly and not via the UN.
Hello, T and Kelly, I am studying the Middle East and politics here at ANU, and I was just wondering, to what extent do you think that the current situation in Syria can be extrapolated back to French colonialism in the area? Thank you.
This is a difficult question. No, actually, I think the current situation is in Syria is I mean, many things in the Middle East are related to the Sykes-Picot agreement, which drew the map of the Middle East and created the basis for many of the conflicts. But I think this conflict is of a completely different nature, and it's not related to it. The political landscape, as it's moving and changing day by day, now has its own dynamics unrelated to that.
When that doctrine was first adopted, it was seen as an enormous step forward, and of course it was the basis for the intervention in Libya, although I think many felt that the NATO forces went beyond the terms of the Security Council resolution. The failure to successfully apply that doctrine in Libya for many observers is very disappointing. Do you think it shows that the doctrine is now dead, or are there special circumstances? Do you think there are prospects for applying the doctrine in other circumstances?
Number one, the Security Council has never adopted the principle of responsibility to protect. It's the General Assembly has, but that has no binding effect. And actually, the responsibility to protect was not referred to in the Libya resolution. And I do not think it will, as the Security Council is now, will ever be referenced in any intervention. And actually, what is happening in Syria shows the enormous discrepancy between lofty principles decided by the General Assembly and the realities on the realities on the ground. So this is again shows the difference between the idealism which you sometimes find in General Assembly resolutions and how policy is conducted.
Yes, Ali Kazak, former Palestinian ambassador. You have played a major role in the Oslo Accord and the negotiations which led to the Declaration of Principles. Then there was less settlements, there was no wall, there was freedom of movement between the West Bank and the Gaza, and you and everyone had great hopes that the situation will improve, not worsen. Since then, what's your views on the situation in Palestine?
Yeah, this is a very interesting question, because the Declaration of Principles or the Oslo Accord is actually not, I mean, a classic peace agreement. What it does is defining the road towards a possible agreement, and it's at a tentative time frame of 5 years to handle the trickiest issues of Jerusalem, refugees, and borders. This has not happened. However, the Palestinian Authority still exists, with its president, with its cabinet, etc. There are possibility now of new elections, and the existence of the Palestinian Authority also formed the basis for giving the Palestinians their new status at the UN. Without the Palestinian Authority, that wouldn't have been possible. But there's also, and this is on the hope side, so to speak, here, is that without the Declaration of Principles and the establishment of the Palestinian Authority, there would never have been a peace agreement between Jordan and Israel. It was a stepping stone. And without the peace agreement between Jordan and Israel, Israel would never have pulled out of southern Lebanon and ended its occupation. I was very fortunate to be the negotiator for this. And without Israel pulling out of Lebanon, Syria would never, 4 years later, have pulled out its 25,000 troops from Lebanon. Again, these are stepping stones. And the Oslo Accords is also the mutual recognition between Israel and the PLO, and without the mutual recognition, there would never be any hope of, or it would be impossible to have negotiations. And I mean, and actually, there are daily contacts between the Palestinian Authority and Israel. And you know, everybody is doing it on the Palestinian side, but it's done outside the public eye. Of course, the talks have failed. For the last 5 years, there's not been absolutely zero progress. And here I would like to say that to make a peace agreement is actually the easiest. The most difficult is the implementation. And if you look at peace agreements, it often takes 20, 30, 40, 50 years to implement peace agreements. Actually, between 30 and 40% of peace agreements relapse into new warfare. So this is why you have to think about peace building, because to sign the paper is easy, but to implement it is difficult. That's why you have to have a very long-term perspective on building peace.
Could you just hold it back, because there are a number of other people, and then we come back to you. Yeah, you go ahead.
Hi, my name's Jo Weir. I'm from the Democratic Progress Institute in London. I was just wondering if you see a role for the Kurdish population, well, what role you see for the Kurdish population playing in Syria?
Concerning the general situation in the region now, it's Tunisia, it's Egypt, it's Yemen, it's Libya, it's Syria, first and foremost, everything is unpredictable. So the only certainty is uncertainty. So I will not predict on anything here. I see, some possibilities for the shorter term where things will go, and in Syria it's basically, as I said, chaos. And where it will move after that chaos is impossible to say, including the fates of the Kurds there.
Hi, excuse me. My name's Lisa Brown. I'm from AusAid. You've spoken about the spillover of some of the fighting into neighbouring countries, and also of the enormous refugee issue that's likely to increase. I was wondering under what circumstance and what you think the likelihood is that some of the neighbouring countries will start closing their borders to refugees?
I did not exactly get the question.
I was wondering under what circumstances and what the likelihood is of neighbouring countries to Syria closing their borders to refugees.
To do what with their borders?
To closing their borders.
It's a good question. If the countries bordering Syria sees that it will destabilize their countries, this is a possibility. But that has, of course, to be weighed against the humanitarian dimension here, because then people might get slaughtered. This is a very hard choice, because if these countries feel this is threatening our very existence, what shall I do? And we might move, for the smaller countries here, into such a situation.
Hi, thank you. My name's Peter. I was actually an undergraduate here last year, but now I work for the Attorney General's Department. And my question is kind of related. I was wondering, we've been hearing in the media a little bit about spillover of the actual fighting and the conflict across borders. I was wondering what you thought the potential was for further spillover and for, given the regional conflict you were describing, for the actual civil conflict to become more internationalized?
There has been cross-border fire, I think, into all the neighboring countries, and I think all the neighboring countries have acted with wisdom and prudence so far. This includes Jordan, Turkey, Iraq, Lebanon, and also Israel. And I think it will continue like that, because it's nobody's interest to create warfare between Syria and these neighboring countries, unless there is some very severe action being taken.
Yes.
My name is Hamad. I'm a PhD student at the Center for Middle Eastern Studies. My question is, do you think we have a slightly more peaceful solution to Syrian crisis? Can you hear me? Hello? Yeah. There's crisis than bombing a country, changing a regime militarily, arming the rebels that you do not know much about, who are themselves divided, and then leave the country at the mercy of regional autocratic regimes who have their own sectarian agenda, whom we can't control even now, and a subsequent unending civil war.
I think actually I've answered the question before. Can we move on?
Yes, we'll go there and then we'll come. I think the Parker who is coming here.
Barry Norton, Center for Arab and Islamic Studies. I wonder if you could comment on the on possible implications for national oil markets flowing from the involvement of Arab states in the Syrian conflict, and also with particular regard to the rosy picture that the International Energy Agency has put forward about the capability of Iraq to significantly increase its oil production.
I didn't understand the first question, I'm sorry.
I was wondering if you could enlarge on possible ways in which the Syrian conflict could result in disruption to international oil markets, given the involvement of Arab countries in the dispute, and in particular, any comment on the rosy future that the International Energy Agency paints for the future of Iraq as a major oil supplier?
I think these are two very different issues, because the first question, I think, is related to if the conflict blows into proportions where it's dragged the key Gulf countries and also other oil-producing countries in the region into the conflict. And of course, that would have major, major consequences for the oil prices and might, worst case, disrupt the global economy and touch the pocketbook of every single of us on the globe. But that's a worst case scenario. Similarly, the regime in Syria has a huge arsenal of chemical weapons. And the fear amongst some, maybe many, is that if the conflict draws to an end and the regime sees that it goes under, that it might use these chemical weapons, maybe not domestically, but against its adversaries in its immediate surroundings. And that would lead to a major conflagration, which I think will have an enormous effect on the oil markets, particularly if there are attacks on Gulf states.
We'll go to Ali and then get you. No, you did. Okay.
Neiman Tolovision from the Center for Arab and Islamic Studies, doing a PhD. My question is from a different angle. Could you please comment on the role of conflict industries? Conflict industries or weapon industries.
Conflict industries.
Okay.
Because it's like a market. It's not only the issue of like local or domestic conflicts, but there is a huge market in industry. How do you see the role of those big industries in inducing conflicts?
I don't think it's any industries who are inducing conflicts on the subjects we are talking about here.
I think that will be the last question.
Richard Curtin, visiting fellow at the Development Policy Center. I want to know to what extent do you think the Syrian conflict is going to influence the Arab, Israeli-Palestinian conflict? What implications can you see in current debates and conflicts over the emerging new leadership in the Palestinian community, and what effect is it having on Israel?
It's several questions in one. What effects it has on Israel, in Israel's strategic realpolitik, the Assad regime, both the father and the son, has provided a stable border for decades. So, I mean, along that single dimension, I think I'm pretty happy about it, because there's been stability on the border between Syria and Israel for decades. But there has now been cross-border attacks, both into UNDOF, the UN peacekeeping operation in its area of operation on the Golan, and there's also been some cross-border incident into Israel proper, which I think is a deep concern to the Israelis, and I think also they are deeply concerned about what kind of a regime will come after Assad, and also if Syria is going to be a land of militias and warlords who could represent a threat of terrorism towards Israel. So I think this is the basic concern related to their border.
Well, we must have exhausted you. I just want to simply say thank you very much for the presentation and for making time to come and speak to us. I've got something for you to, one, to remember the ANU by. It's something that you could hang on your wall, and this is something that you can hang around your neck.
Thank you very much. I hope it's not a rope.
It's not. We are not in the habit of giving ropes to anybody at this university. And I want to thank you very much. Would you please join me?
Thank you so much. Great questions. Great discussion. And I was very pleased to be invited here. And I'm even more pleased to say thank you for a great evening.
Thank you.